Dr. Rita Kronidis, Director of the Global Humanities Institute at Montgomery College. The Global Humanities Institute was created in 2012 with the support of a Bridging Cultures Challenge grant from the National Endowment for the Humanities. The aim of the grant is to engage the power of the humanities to promote understanding and mutual respect for people with diverse histories, cultures, and perspectives within the U.S. and abroad. At Montgomery College, the purpose of the Global Humanities Institute is to support the systematic integration of other cultures and countries to the study of the humanities. The project also includes faculty training and supportive teaching, cultural community engagement, research and scholarly work, and scholarly exchanges abroad as we travel to China, India, and El Salvador. Another exciting facet of our project is our Distinguished Speaker Series, featuring renowned experts in international education, the humanities, and global studies. Recently, we hosted a presentation and question and answer session with Dr. Carol Schneider, the president of the Association of American Colleges and Universities, and one of our country's major education leaders. Dr. Schneider spoke on the Germantown campus about the value of the humanities and the liberal arts in the world today, and was introduced by Dr. Sanjay Rai, Acting Vice President for Academic Affairs at Montgomery College.
Now I'm happy to introduce our featured speaker. Dr. Carol Schneider has provided exemplary leadership to the American Association for Colleges and Universities for more than 15 years. First as Vice President and then as President. In many years, she is AAC&U. Dr. Schneider has earned the respect of her colleagues in higher education. We look to her, to the association, to guide and support us in thinking creatively about the higher education and what higher education should be for our students today and also tomorrow. Her vision has focused on making higher education inclusive and responsive to changing needs. She has led initiatives that promote excellence in instruction and assessment, efforts that deliver the best possible education to our students. A great many institutions have adopted these initiatives and are trained the best practices, including LEAP, or Liberal Education in America's Promise, Greater Expectations, Commitment to Quality as a Nation Goes to College, the Community College Student Roadmap, and Essential Learning Outcomes. For many years, Dr. Schneider has delivered the message that we shortchange our students when we deprive them of general education, the liberal arts and humanities, and those disciplines that enable the students to be important contributing members of our society. Today, we eagerly await her ideas on the importance of global humanities to our students. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Carol Schneider.
Well, good afternoon, and thank you for coming, and thank you for that really kind introduction. I need to say right at the outset that literally everything I'm about to talk about this afternoon, I got from and learned from people like you. So I see myself as part of a feedback loop, and I hope that we can sketch a big picture that helps you situate your work in an important context for our students and for our society. But I'm eager to get to the point where we actually talk to each other. I'm going to be sharing with you some work that AAC&U has been doing for a while, but then I want to come to what we see as our next bold idea, and I look to you to tell me whether or not it's a viable bold idea, but I'm trying it out on you. So we'll see how that works. There's a handout for the session. Did everyone get it? I will, at various points, be referring to it. If we need more, there's some in a brown folio over by the side. Yes, right there. And I understand I have students here, right? I am required assignment for at least one class. Thank you for and I'm particularly eager to have your comments and your responses. How are the acoustics? I was mindful that the two Microphones are a challenge. They're working now. Excellent, excellent. So let me give you an overview of what we're going to be talking about. First of all, I'm going to spend a little time on vocabulary just to get us all on the same page. Then I'm going to move to the big context in which you are situating your work on the global humanities and help us re-engage the kinds of challenges our students face and that we face in a global community. Then I'll be talking about the learning students need to actually contribute as well as navigate within this broader global context. All big picture, you are the ones who fill in the detail and make it real for the students. But I will be painting a picture, I hope, of where we're going. And then I want to move to the question of how this institute and the kind of work you are doing might step forward to assist us all in thinking where higher education goes, where a good education goes, and frankly, what the humanities have to contribute and the ways in which they can lead in making education work even more powerfully for today's students. So that's the big picture, but let's go first to vocabulary. I was in a little interview before in which people were asking me to explain, well, what are the humanities? And the fact of the matter is our society does not know. We've all been, how many people in the room are not in humanities? A couple. All right. So most of us are humanists. We're among friends. We've all been treated to the sight of governors, literally proposing to charge more for students who major in a humanities field than for others, even though other fields are often more expensive to provide. We've all been treated to governors and other political figures suggesting that certain disciplines, always humanities disciplines, are not a good investment if you actually want to have a job. I am here to provide a counter-narrative, but first of all, let's just talk about the language in which we're describing all this. So the liberal arts and sciences. Those of you who had a traditional education know that in the United States, the liberal arts does include the sciences, has included it for more than a century, but it is absolutely the case that a lot of people think the liberal arts is really just the humanities or the humanities and social sciences. So I am actually going to be focusing on the broad learning all students need and on the special role that humanities disciplines, disciplines like English, history, international studies, global studies, cultural studies, add to students' preparation for the world of work, for our democracy, and for global community. Liberal arts colleges, you're not a liberal arts college, but I cannot tell you how many people out there think that liberal arts happens only at liberal arts colleges, and students above all. We've done focus groups with students, and they think whatever it is, it's what's done in small private colleges. So that's part of the context in which we're all operating. A failure to explain our terms, and more importantly, the substance behind what we do to the larger society. General education, I remember when I was a graduate student at Harvard, I found myself TAing in a gen ed course. I was at Mount Holyoke, as Rita was, and we never used the language of general education at Mount Holyoke, so I said to my husband, what does it mean? He said, it means they have to take it. Which was the only orientation I ever got to general education until I actually had a job, in which case I found myself immediately on the Gen Ed Reform Committee. How many of you have been on the Gen Ed Reform Committee? Exactly. I want to argue that general education is an essential part of every student's preparation for college. But the real framing that AAC&U uses is liberal education. We've gone back to an 18th century and a 19th century term. Before there was gen ed, before there was majors, before we even talked about disciplines, there was an understanding that a certain kind of education prepared you for democracy, that there was a connection between liberal education and our future as a free society. Not a politically divided free society, but a united, moving forward together free society. So I am an historian by training. We've gone back to that framing, liberal education and America's promise. And our argument is that whatever students are majoring in, every student needs the component elements of a broad liberal education to be capable of making progress in and contributing to the world of which they're a part. I'll come back to the particulars of that meaning, but I want you to understand we have an ecumenical approach to liberal education. The humanities are absolutely indispensable to a good liberal education, but they do not own it. They do not own it. And we all have to understand that we're in this together across the career and technical fields as well as the arts and sciences. So That's clarifying our terms, and you can see a guide to it on page 2 of the handout if you want to take away some of the definitions I'm using. But now I want to clarify our topic as well. What I hope to share with you, discuss with you, is the possibility of a genuine leadership role for the humanities in remapping the educational pathways through which our students experience college and gain the knowledge and preparation they need for success in the wider world. And I hope that will come to have some meaning as we go forward in this talk. That's my big topic, and that's where my big idea is going. But I also want to start by setting the larger context and reminding ourselves of the world for which we're preparing our students and the challenges that world presents to them. The reality is that education only succeeds if it connects with the obligations and responsibilities of the larger society. And for our students, those expectations come first and foremost in terms of the economy and jobs. So we have to take seriously what it means to prepare students for today's economy, just as we also have to take seriously what it means to prepare them for global community and democratic responsibility. So what do students need to succeed in that wider world? What are the kinds of learning that they will need to fulfill all the obligations of their professional, career, civic, and personal lives? The reality is, I said before, that everything I have to say to you has been drawn from people watching higher education, paying attention to what people like you are inventing in your classrooms, in your curricula, on your campuses, and in your communities. And I would argue that the 21st Century Academy has been in transition for some time, trying to adapt its practices, just as this Global Humanities Institute is doing, to the needs of a very volatile and very fast-changing world. For a while, when I said something like this in one of my talks, I would say, we're not quite sure where we're going. We know we need to prepare students for an innovation-fueled economy, for global community. We want to make sure that they're helping to build more just and humane and inclusive societies. But the question of what that meant for curricular remapping, for rethinking the parameters and practices of higher education, all that has been in flux for a while. But I think a new direction is now coming into focus, and that will be the focus of my talk as well. Well, let's start first with the economic challenges and with the reality that every single student who comes to Montgomery College once is here because he or she, and certainly their families, want to make sure that they have opportunity in the economy. And what does that mean? The reality is that college learning, much more is being asked of college learners and of those who educate them in the 21st century economy than ever before. Now, I don't need to tell you, I'm sure you tell yourselves and tell your students every day, that more students will need to have college degrees to succeed in this economy. That's well known. But what is less well known and less frequently discussed is the fact that employers now expect more of those who are actually in the academy. They want higher and they also want broader levels of learning than ever before. Now, my association has as its mission liberal education in the terms that I described it before. We came to understand some time ago that if we were going to have to make the case successfully for liberal education, we would need to have employers arm in arm with us, talking about the kind of work that you do and why it matters. And I was trained in intellectual history in my graduate studies. I understand perfectly well that the typical employer does not use the term liberal education or liberal arts education when he or she talks about what they're looking for. But I also have been taught to listen for meaning, and I soon came to understand that in their own vocabulary, employers were asking for more and better liberal education, not less, and certainly not narrow, truncated, reductive education. So I'm going to share with you some of the work that we've done over the last decade to try to put our employers arm in arm with us, making the case that students need a broad education, a horizon-expanding education, a liberating education, to be prepared for the economy, for the workplace. So let me spend a little time on that. First of all, the larger context, and again, you're in the Global Humanities Institute or supportive of it already. You don't need to be reminded that this is a world of global interdependence and that our customers and our clients and our partners in the economy often come from other parts of the world or are in other parts of the world. We're all engaged in partnerships, and so that means that people who are in the workplace need to know something about countries and peoples and folkways beyond the ones they grew up with. And it's also true that rapid scientific and technological change is affecting every single enterprise inevitably, so that fast-fueled change is the name of the game in every workplace, including our academic workplaces. We're all being asked to adapt, to invent new practices. That is true in every part of our economy, and it sets the context for what employers are saying and asking for. So we've done a series of surveys with employers, and I'm about to share with you some of the things that they have said to us. Can you read this?
Yes.
In the back? Okay, your eyes are better than mine. So 95% of employers said, this is our most recent survey, one titled It Takes More Than a Major. It was done for us by a polling firm. We did not do this ourselves. 95% of employers say that they give hiring preference in college graduates with skills that will enable them to contribute to innovation in the workplace. That is what they're looking for. That's a filter through which they are evaluating your graduates. 93% of them say that they're asking current employees to take on more and broader responsibilities. And those responsibilities include better understanding what other units and other departments and other partners are doing. So they don't use the language of interdisciplinary learning or integrative learning, but they are asking for people who can put things together. 91% of the employers say that the challenges their employees are facing are more complex than in the past, and so they want people who can deal with complexity, who are used to thinking through beyond the obvious to the unexplored and the possible. And 88% of them agree that to succeed in my company, people are going to need broader and higher levels of learning than ever before. Another portrait of this is drawn, this is an image we got from the Council for Competitiveness, a business group. And what it shows you is the, I have a little thing here, never mind. If you look at that line going up, it's asking for complex communication skills and expert knowledge. And the lines going down have to do with the demand for routine cognitive skills and routine manual skills. What this captures for our economy is something very important for all of us to know. If a job can be done to rule, it is already either been automated or being automated or outsourced. If it can be done to known rules, people have figured out how to do it with as little human activity as possible. That's where productivity is coming from in our economy. So the opportunity comes for those who are capable of dealing with the problems to which we do not yet have solutions. The things where there are not yet known rules for how to get something done. The things that call for judgment. The things that call for thinking through the evidence. The things that call for taking into account the different perspectives on what the problem really is and how to solve it. The more people are prepared for that kind of learning, and the humanists in the room are recognizing themselves in this picture, I know, the more they are prepared for the jobs where opportunity is in this economy and where opportunity is going to remain going forward. So we have to prepare students who are capable of functioning in that universe. We need to prepare people who think of themselves as innovators and problem solvers and who know how to take risks in measured ways, know how to think through the evidence about what constitutes a genuine risk, a bridge too far, and what constitutes a good bet. People who bring judgment and integrity to the problems that they're trying to solve. So employers, they don't use the language of the liberal arts, but they say all the time, we want people who can think outside the box. Now I'm quoting employers in focus groups. They do not want people who are locked into mental cubicles and who can only look at things from one point of view. Employer focus group that we did told us that people who have that mindset, know only how to think in one set of rules, will be left behind. We're changing fast, they said. They have to be prepared to move with us, or the jobs, they just won't be promotable, and they may not be people we'll keep. So they don't want people, now there's a quote here from an entrepreneur in Singapore, a person who has a PhD in physics, actually, telling people who want to be in business, international business, you cannot go into a cave until you figure out the right solution. You have to work with all the people around you. You need to be able to think outside that box. Another term just from employers, again, a focus group that was done for us in this area, they hit on the term, we want people who have that 360-degree perspective, people who will look at the whole picture before they rush to judgment. Well, in my mind, that 360-degree perspective is a global, cross-cultural, intercultural perspective. And our students need to understand how important that is to the silent evaluations that are going on of performance every single day, every single hour. Now, in our surveys of employers, we've asked them various kinds of questions. One takes the form of, should higher education place more emphasis, less emphasis, or the same emphasis on certain aspects of college learning? And you have on the handout that I've given you employers' answers to that question. It's page 5. If it comes with a little box, star, employers think there should be more emphasis on it. If it comes with a little box, employers were responding to the question, whatever they major in, do you agree that all students need? So you'll see both on this slide and on this handout, whatever they're majoring in, 80% of employers agree that all students need a broad foundation in the liberal arts and sciences. That was the exact item, and that's what they responded to. But 78% of them say that all students need, whatever they're majoring in, more knowledge about global issues and cultures and problems outside the one they grew up with. They want people to know more about the rest of the world. In a previous survey, one that was done in 2008, we asked employers to grade graduates they had hired on certain aspects of college. And frankly, the lowest grade was given to higher education and to people they'd hired for their global knowledge. They literally failed them, failing grade overall. So employers are looking for people who are doing exactly what you were here to do, provide students with a deeper, richer, fuller understanding of the rest of the world. But of course, it's not just the economy. As I said at the outset, we are a democracy, we are a global community, we have a responsibility to one another. And higher education has to be a continuing and persuasive leader, that it's not enough to get our students ready for the jobs of tomorrow. That's important, necessary, but not sufficient. We are all also educating them to take responsibility for solving the many challenges we face as a democracy and that we face in the global community. And you know those challenges as well as I do. They're daunting. Everywhere in this country and around the world, we encounter poverty, suffering, war. We hope for a world in which human dignity and sustenance and justice is taken for granted, but that's not the world we have. And it will have to be people, real people, the ones we're educating now, here and in other parts of the world, who move us away from a condition of chronic suffering to expanded human dignity and inclusion. We're infused by illiteracy and its effects everywhere. In this society, we still have lots of people who are coming through our schools illiterate or barely literate. And in other parts of the world, of course, literacy is still a privilege, not something you can just take for granted. We need to build our capacity to provide education and through it opportunity, not just for Americans, but for all those people around the world who don't yet have access to it. Energy and the environment, I'm sure there are people in this room who themselves give speeches, teach classes on this issue, fundamental to our future, to contest it in our society. We not only need to solve these problems, we need to help persuade our fellow citizens that they must be solved, that these are real issues that threaten the sustainability of our planet and our communities. Terrorism and fear, we long for a world that is infused by law and justice, and self-determination. That is not the world in which most human beings live. So if we are going to create the kind of communities here and abroad, if we are going to take seriously the notion of global interdependence as a state that improves opportunity for people, then we have to graduate students who see it as their responsibility to take on this work. Too much of our conversation about higher education has been privatized. What's in it for me? How much will I make? Which career will give me the best economic opportunity? Yes, those are important questions. But if we only ask what's in it for me, we're not asking the questions that are most important to our future as a shared planet. So we must take responsibility for helping students understand what it means to take global interdependence, the sustainability of our future, as their responsibility, not just somebody else's. So what kind of education is that? You already know my answer to it. A broad liberal education is the kind of education that builds capacity both to succeed in the economy, but also to take your role, your shared role, in creating solutions to our civic and global future. But let's talk in more detail about what that really means and what kind of education actually prepares students for all those complexities. How many of you are familiar with AAC&U's work on the essential learning outcomes? A few. Not necessarily everyone. This is the part where I turn to you as a source of the insights that we've gained. AAC&U has been asking faculty members around the country for more than a decade, what do you think students need to be well prepared for the kind of environment and which I've just described, a global environment, a fast-changed, innovation-fueled environment. And you'll see on the handout some of the details on what your answers have been. So we've captured them on page 3 of the handout and what AAC&U calls the essential learning outcomes, the component elements of a strong, horizon-expanding liberal education for every student, whatever their actual major. Broad knowledge of human cultures in the natural and physical world. Broad knowledge in all the disciplines that you represent, but focused by engagement with big questions, the kind of questions that we need to tackle in the economy and in our society. A set of intellectual and practical skills that virtually every employer will tell you they want more of, and you already saw the employer survey, the latest of several, on page 5, showing how much employers think we need to spend more attention on these intellectual skills, practiced extensively, not in some classes, but in every class. Personal and social responsibility, civic engagement at home and abroad, intercultural knowledge and competence, ethical reasoning and action, the foundations and skills for continued learning, because continued learning is the name of the game, but all of this anchored through actual experience. It's not enough to just read about these things. We have to be doing the work that builds the intercultural competence, that builds our capacity to create solutions for our future. Now, all of this builds thus far on what I would say are the age-old goals of a liberal arts education. Broad knowledge of the world around you, developing the powers of the mind to the highest possible potential, ethical, civic responsibility, moral integrity. Those are traditional goals. They're not just 21st century goals. I would argue it's the last piece, the notion of integrating and applying the learning, that makes this a 21st century vision. We are a can-do nation in a very needful world. And so we need to give our students abundant practice, not just in knowing things, not just in practicing skills, but in actually bringing their knowledge, judgment, and intellectual capacities to bear on problems that we have to solve. And I'll come back to what that actually means as we go forward. But that's the big vision, and it applies to every discipline students are in. But it is equally true that you couldn't possibly achieve this vision if you left out the humanities, or the social sciences, or the sciences, or the arts, all equally important to that broad foundation and preparation for the wider world. So this vision came from faculty, and on page 4 of the handout, I've given you the results of a survey we did a couple of years ago of our member institutions, 1,300 institutional members, half public, half private, 150 community colleges are part of that membership. We asked them which of these goals they actually required of their students. Now, first question, do you have expected learning outcomes for all your students? And if you do, which of the items on a list are on your set of goals for your institution? So 80% of those responding to this survey had a 48% response rate, and 80% of those responding said, yes, we have institutional goals. My argument has been the other 20% had not recently been up for accreditation. You can't get through accreditation without having this discussion. Our question is, how deep did this discussion go? Is this a list someone created somewhere, or does it actually frame what students think they're in college to achieve? Two different questions. But you can see that overwhelmingly, our members and you are embracing that broad knowledge, and you'll notice that for global world cultures, 87% say it's required somewhere in the college curriculum. And then under intellectual and practical skills, you'll see that intercultural skills, 79% of our members say that they have made this an expectation for all students learning. Interestingly, ethical reasoning, 75% of our members say that's on their list of goals for students' outcomes. I'm not sure how many of us are actually assessing the ethical reasoning, but nonetheless, we say this is part of what we aspire to. And the lowest numbers are still two-thirds saying we want students to be able to integrate their learning and to apply their learning. So a consensus. And the reason I've set these in this handout, the member responses on one side and the employer responses on the other, is for you to see that there is a consensus between employers and educators on the learning students actually need for this economy and for global community. Which then brings us to the challenge of how we actually help students achieve this kind of learning. What do we need to do to live up to this shared aspiration for horizon-expanding learning that prepares students to contribute and succeed in a complicated world? The humanities are indispensable to the kind of vision we're talking about, but the humanities cannot do it alone. We need all the disciplines. We need the technical fields, the science fields, the career fields, the social sciences, just as much as we need the humanities. They need to come together in this vision so that our students have a full and multidimensional understanding of the challenges they inherit and the kind of tools that are available to help solve our problems. But at the same time, and this is my argument for you as a Global Humanities Institute, I think the humanities could, and I would argue should, step out to map and model a transformative vision for how we do this. Not just insisting that the humanities cannot be removed from the curriculum, which is what a lot of us have been forced into, but rather to map and model an approach to education so powerful that people will insist on having more of it. So how can we do that? First of all, I think we go back into the strengths of the humanities themselves. Narrative imagination, a term I've borrowed from Martha Nussbaum. If you have not read her books on the humanities and their role in global community, you certainly must. Cross-cultural and historical perspective, so foundational to our ability to do anything that needs to be accomplished in the world. Ethical inquiry and discernment, not limited to the humanities, but we, of course, have the disciplines that spend the most time on these very foundational issues, important in every field. Deep engagement with ultimate questions and values, not just how can we do something, but should we do something? To what end are we doing things? These are the questions that we routinely ask in our scholarship, explore in our work. We need to make sure that our students understand that this is what they're getting out of the humanities. This is the special addition that the humanities make to global preparation for the economy and for community. But also sources of hope. What is possible for our society? What could we be that we have not yet been? Sources of consolation. Many of us are suffering in our experience of the communities that we are part of. Through millions of kinds of neglects and omissions and acts of bias and prejudice, people are suffering. The humanities can offer us deep sources of consolation on issues that we are all feeling and sources of hope for where we might go to create a better experience for ourselves and for others. Sources of joy. We spend too little time, I think, as an academy talking about the ways in which we enrich lives by leading people to possibilities that they did not themselves know when they arrived on a college campus. So those are the special ingredients that the humanities bring. But I want to argue that there is another future dimension for our work, that we need to see it as our task to map and model what it means to prepare students to deal with unscripted problems and big questions, the kind of big questions that I talked about before, the things we need to solve as a society, that we are still trying to figure out the answer to what that means. So what would it take to actually be part of the solution rather than someone who is simply analyzing the problems that we face? Students need the capacity to envision. They need to be able to think through what is possible, where we might go, what others have brought to this, what the history is, what the contestations are, what the debates are. This, of course, is one of the strengths of the humanities. I see the humanities as envisioning disciplines, disciplines that help us think beyond the obvious, think beyond those mental cubicles into a world of possibility and promise. We need analytical skills, obviously, to test alternatives. I want to argue that one of the great strengths of a good college education is that it teaches people the difference between having an opinion and knowing what the evidence is. Mm-hmm. know what you're actually talking about. This is what I got out of my Mount Holyoke education. Did you get that out of your Mount Holyoke education, Rita? The difference between making an evidence-based argument and just making a top-of-the-head judgment. We need to give our students profound experiences and understanding what the difference is and why it matters that we bring evidence to bear on the solutions we're proposing. The desire and ability to solve problems across difference. Now, this is an extraordinarily diverse college community. I understand that. You have resources that many institutions only wish they have, and the perspectives, experiences, and insights that your students are bringing to you from different kinds of racial, ethnic, and communal backgrounds, and often from different parts of the world. You don't just have to go abroad in this part of the country to have a global experience. And it's our challenge to make sure that our students are having cross-cultural discussions of deep value and import wherever they are. The ethical judgment and the wisdom to consider what we should do, what's worth doing, and the consequences. Who will benefit? Who will lose from the things that we're talking about? These are humanistic questions. They need to infuse the kinds of topics and assignments we're giving to our students in our courses. But also the commitment to devote time and talent to making a better world. It is up to us to correct a truncated narrative that has captured our society that it's only about jobs and it's only about making as much money as possible. We have to bring the courage of our vision and our commitments to right course a truncated discussion about what education means in our society. I want to go back to the Truman. And how many of you have actually ever looked at the Truman Commission report, 1947? And what's its significance to community colleges, those of you who've looked at it?
Laid the foundation for community colleges.
It laid the foundation for ramping up the investment in community colleges across the country. A six-volume report, now we bring out 30-page reports, but then they really did it seriously, six volumes. And three principal goals for higher education, including community colleges, spelled out in that report. The first of them was the fuller realization of democracy in every sphere of life. The second, building international cooperation and understanding. And the third, one that I think is particularly salient to our topic today, language I love, the goal is to bring creative imagination and trained intelligence to the solution of social problems. Creative imagination and trained intelligence to the solution of social problems. Work was not actually mentioned as one of the three principal goals. I'm perfectly willing to add it as a fourth principal goal, but I think it is our job as a community to help our society reclaim these goals and start with this one, because I think everyone sees that we need social imagination and trained intelligence in the workplace, in our communities, in the global community, and without it, we do not have a future as a democracy. I believe the humanities can lead in reclaiming this vision and also, equally important, remapping the pathways so that we're not just talking the talk, but teaching our students what it means to walk the walk and create the solutions. And that brings me to the idea I really want to talk with you about, at least briefly in my presentation and more interactively as we move to the discussion. And it's the notion of expecting that every student will be engaged in significant ways with unscripted questions, big questions, big problems, contemporary and enduring, and that we will ask each student as he or she enters college to either identify or discover through their studies a signature problem that they want to work on. A signature problem that they want to work on, something that matters to that student in terms of his or her career aspirations, in terms of his or her hopes for her family, community, perhaps they already see themselves as global citizens. What is a question worth working on that can give focus and integration to their learning, certainly within the humanities, but across, assuming that they're not humanities majors, across the humanities and the other disciplines in which they are working? What is a signature problem that they take seriously, and what is their responsibility and their emerging capacity to help create solutions to that problem? So how might we think about this? The first year experience would introduce, we would see ourselves as introducing students to illustrative problems that we need to solve, whether in the economy or in global community or in our own neighborhoods. The entire educational experience, the 2 years here and the period beyond, if they transfer, would be designed as building students' capacities. All those broad abstract skills I was talking about are brought to bear. We're not just learning how to make evidence-based arguments, we're learning how to make evidence-based arguments about a problem you care about. That's what you're here to do. That's what a 21st century education means, that you are becoming deeply knowledgeable about something that matters to you, and your skills, your knowledge are all contributing to that capacity. The student's portfolio, some of them may have e-portfolios, some of them simply may have a body of work they've done, demonstrates their deep engagement and their expanding growth and their ability to bring something to the table. It shows what they've learned from others and with others. It shows whether or not they have actually been working on all those capacities we and employers agree they need for work, for learning, to be well educated. Now, disciplinary study, students major is still foundational. I am not one of these people who is ready to simply throw out study in depth in a particular field. I understand its strength in building the capacity to make arguments using specific tools. But it would be equally important in this vision that students have experience in connecting their discipline, their major, whatever it is, with other perspectives of other fields and of other communities. That's what a Global Humanities Institute perspective can bring to them. And both for citizenship and for work, students would be engaged in deep ways with problems. They can describe the significance, they can describe what they've done, they can describe why it matters. I put this in front of you because, as I'm sure I do not need to tell you, we are in the midst of ongoing, urgent pleas with all of us to just get with the digital revolution, to put our courses online, to seize all the opportunities for imparting knowledge faster and less expensively. I want to argue that we should be using the digital revolution to free up more space for the kind of deep inquiry and deep engagement with significant questions that my proposal entails. Yes, there's a lot of ways in which the things that are routinized in terms of the students have to learn certain rules, they have to be exposed to certain information, this can be done through digital strategies and through lots of imaginative modes that are far superior to the what I went to school on, the traditional lecture. But what we don't spend enough time with, we know this from abundant research, first generation students less likely to do research than anybody else, less likely to have courses in the humanities, the social sciences, the arts, even computer technology, and certainly languages, than anybody else. First generation students less likely to engage in internships, in projects, in collaborative work than others. The fact of the matter is we know what works for our students. We know because you, faculty like you, have invented all kinds of hands-on strategies for helping students go deeper into a question. But the reality is that on most college and university campuses, students have to know where to look to find these things. And if they don't have experienced parents or family members sending them in the right direction, the chances that they will miss out on what constitutes our best and most empowering forms of learning are very high. I want to finish with a story from somebody who actually works at AAC&U. He's a graduate of a community college in Maryland, transferred to UMBC, had a good education both places. We interviewed him when he first came to work for us. Double major in dance and networking technology. Right, and I asked him what connections he saw, and he could explain connections, that both of them involved webs of connection and interpretation, and that he had done this in technology, but he's older now, the founder of a dance company called Dakshina, if any of you have ever heard of it. So the fact of the matter is that his education worked for him in every possible integrative way. He found himself, he found his purpose, he found an income-producing career that helped him found that dance company, and he's a creative individual as well. So I said to him, and I particularly liked that he found his future in dance in a gen ed requirement, that he was fulfilling his gen ed requirement. He did it with international dance, created a future for himself out of that experience. So I said to him, it sounds like all the things AAC&U recommends really happened for you. And he said, I hope you don't think I was typical. He said, for every student who had the kind of experience that I had, and it was a good one, there's 100 others that are just going through the motions. They're choosing their courses by the time of the day they're offered. they don't really know why they're doing what they're doing. They're getting less out of college than they thought they would, and I would add, than they definitely need. So the fact of the matter is we know, and you know, how to provide an extraordinary education to your students. What we haven't figured out yet is how to make this expected, unavoidable for everyone. And that's where I think our future lies, and that's where I think the question of getting students engaged with signature projects, signature work, the unscripted problems that are so important to our economy, to our democracy, to global community. This should be our future, and I look forward to talking with you about it. Thank you.
I can stand up here and ask or help with taking questions. We do have plenty of time for questions, everyone. So if you have anything on your mind you want to bring up, this would be a good time.
Or reservations. And tell me who you are.
Hello. Hi, I'm Daniel. I'm Daniel.
Daniel, are you a student?
Yes.
Okay, good.
I'm here with an Asian history class.
Okay.
Hi, so yeah, I have a question. What about, so the issue that we're trying, that the ideas that we're trying to kind of get over is, you know, students that aren't necessarily thoroughly involved and fundamentally kind of intellectually immersed in college. I understand you guys have done a lot of research as to try to point out what the problems are and to try to find ways as to the solutions. But what about, I didn't hear any talk about incentives as to kind of, what is it that can be done to try to really catch a student's eye and say, hey, this is why you should register for here, this is why you should act in this direction, like to actually kind of, a carrot. That's what my boss called them, you know, the carrot.
The carrot. That's an extraordinary question, and one that reminds me that I skipped over some key points. I'd really like to know your answer to that question. So would answer it yourself, and then I will do my best to see if my answer is as good as yours. Remember, we're helping turning you into a problem solver for our future. So how would you help solve this problem?
Are you actually asking me right now?
Yeah. I'm just going to guess you're closer to more students at this point in your life than I am.
Well, for me, I mean, I know that I can kind of talk about how certain things were easier for me. And I mean, I'm a working student. I'm a manager in training at a cafe in Rockville. For me, although I know my parents weren't, you know, my parents did go to college. My dad was a Fulbright scholar. He came to the U.S. in 84, 85 or so with my brother. And I know, like, for me, from a young age, I had, you know, the advantage of having parents that were really like, do your homework, you know?
Right, they took education seriously.
Yeah, they took my education really seriously. And I know that was kind of luck, I was really lucky in that respect. But I wonder how is it that, I don't really know because I feel like it comes down to like the parents, I guess. I mean, that was kind of the solution for me. It was, you know, the proper parenting. Yeah. But what's that? Yeah. I don't know how you can translate that into, you know, the college setting. Because, I mean, we can't, as a college, you know, professors can't go into every student's home and say, you know.
No, but one of the advantages you have in a community college is that most of your classes are comparatively small to what you would be experiencing at some of the larger universities. So a key point in this whole notion of helping a student find a signature project that they care about starts with asking the student what they do care about. When I was at Mount Holyoke back in the Middle Ages, required course in baby English, as we called it. Was it so-called baby English when you were there? Had they gotten over that? Anyway, I'd actually tried to get out of this English course, which I did not think I needed, and I did not succeed in getting out of it. But in fact, it was one of those transformative first semester experiences that really changed my way of thinking about what I was in school for. And it came down to, this faculty member brought every single student that in the class into her office for a private interview, 30-minute interview, and she asked us what we were really thinking about. What was a problem that mattered to us? She was actually trying to set us up for a research paper, and it happened I had her for 2 semesters. So she got into my particular problem the assignment she gave me based on it really expanded my understanding of what I was doing in college. And then she sort of stayed with it second semester to build it for me. But the key point is that she asked me what was on her, on my mind. She did not set out with a list of courses I needed to take to fulfill requirements. And so much of what happens to a first semester student, they are here. They have enrolled with some notion that they ought to be in college. They may have very thin connections to college, and I used to work with a lot of students who did, but they thought they needed it. So why did they think they needed it? And I think we have to take seriously their career concerns. I think we have to start with wherever they are, and if what they want is to be employable and promotable, then I think we have to enlarge their understanding of what that means. And by creating more opportunities in the first year to actually dig into something you care about, I think we create more carrots for the students to see themselves as growing in a direction that will actually help them. I think all too often, as my colleague Daniel was saying, they don't know why they're doing what they're doing. We haven't made that connection for them. And if they're borrowing money and have a million pressures on them to drop out of school, all too easily we lose them. I think we have to help them see their future in the very first things they do in college. And that's behind the signature project or question, is the notion of something you actually care about. And I think, I mean, if I told you how I answered that question to Ms. Brock in the 1960s, you would be appalled at the naivete. All right, I'll tell you. I wanted to know, I finally told her somewhat reluctantly, whether miracles proved that the Catholic Church was the one true church. And I was willing to do my research paper on that. She did not laugh. She thought. She looked serious. And she said, Mrs. Geary, I think it would be useful to you to study Christian mysticism, Christian mystical experiences, mystical poets. And then she added, and I think you should do some non-Christian mystics as well. And she sent me off to some books on the subject. She totally transformed my understanding of what religious experience could mean. She moved me away from magic, which is where I was, to the notion of ultimate questions, transformative experiences, deep encounters with something beyond oneself. It made a huge difference to my thinking about my own obligations, but equally important had everything to do with where I went in my scholarship. If you tracked my work in college and tracked my doctoral dissertation, which is called The Holy Commonwealth, you would see that those questions that were personal for me when I was 18 were turned into scholarly questions as I moved forward. Now, everybody doesn't need to be a scholar. I am not arguing that. But I am saying that by thoughtful listening to our students, we can find ways to make more of the things that actually motivate them. And I hope that might be a decent answer to your question. Did you want to?
Oh, well, the only other question I was thinking of, because I spent a year, my sophomore year of high school, I lived in Maputo in Mozambique with my dad. My dad is a international public health specialist, so he traveled all the time. And when I was there, I went to an IB school for just a year.
International baccalaureate?
Yeah, international baccalaureate, I think.
You're expected to do, as a senior,
you have to do their senior research projects. And I had a friend, he was like, I did martial arts back then, he was like the black belt in our class. He did his project on chaos theory. I knew this other guy who did a kind of a stadium design. He wanted to, because they were going to have the World Cup that year in South Africa. And he kind of wanted to go into like eco stadiums and like technology that, you know, promotes healthy building and good building. And I mean, I was just curious. So like as a project for students, would it be strictly like research oriented? Would it be kind of in academic formats, or would it be something more kind of, I want to say, more at home, like take home, think about this assignment yourself, kind of interest?
Boy, I am so out of my depth in that question. How would faculty members answer that? I cannot tell you how you would do a good research project connecting chaos theory to the needs of a stadium, if I understood your question.
Oh, well, I mean, those are just examples, but
right.
I mean, like what would be kind of, I always like to do my projects like reading a rubric. I say, okay, you want this, 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 and this, and this. And you know, that's, okay, cool. You know, let me make up my assignment, you know, like answer the questions, right? And that's kind of how I get decent grades.
Right.
And then, and so, but I'm just thinking, like, how would kind of trying to answer something that's really kind of an abstract idea translate?
Oh, okay, all right. So you're not talking about that particular project. I think it entirely depends. I envision a combination of either a practicum, an internship, or research with courses related to it. But the faculty members are basically inviting students to say, what project are you, what's your topic? And how can we connect the requirements, the assignments in this course to things that will build more of your topic? Not for all of your courses. If you have, 20 courses in 2 years here? Not for every single one of them, but a chunk of them, so that there's a piece of the educational experience that's helping you identify what goes into your signature work, and then helps you work on it from different angles. So that's how I see it. Do you do e-portfolios here? Is that something that's happening at Montgomery College? In some fields, right. Right, I mean, the easy way to think about it is that you are building a transparent portfolio, and work goes into it, so that whoever's advising you can actually take a look at what you've been about, not just what your interests are, but how good you are at that evidence-based reasoning I was talking about. Back to Ms. Brock at Mount Holyoke, she undoubtedly, this paper that I did for her, which in my mind was this huge intellectual breakthrough. At Mount Holyoke, long before there were portfolios, they actually gave us our senior papers when we graduated. Was that still true for you? No, okay, so it's gone by the 80s. But they kept all our papers in a white box and gave it, freshman papers, gave them back to us when we graduated. So I raced for this paper. It was so naive. It was truly naive, very descriptive, not analytical. And anybody looking at it would see that I needed more work on building an argument using evidence. And in fact, since I had her second semester, that's exactly what she had me doing, building an argument using evidence. And that's one of the benefits, I think, of portfolios, that people can take a look at not just what you're about, but where you are in that journey. But there are lots of other, you don't have to have technology to support this. You can do it just by having mentors and advisors with whom you are constantly talking, who take you seriously. And it sounds to me like you already have that.
I'm going to turn it over to Sarah now.
And tell me who you are.
Sarah Ducey, and I direct the Paul Pack Humanities Institute, the other Humanities
Institute. Oh, okay.
So we're like sisters.
Yeah.
So we are up against something that's really frustrating, which is that for our veterans, they can't take a course unless it is directly related to the completion in their major. That we have legislation in our state that is pushing us to
legislation in the state
just the facts jack kind of courses. So we're actually, you're presenting the most gorgeous model, and we've actually been talking about this, how to achieve these things, and yet we're up against a straitjacket. So if you have a student who has the first question that you have in religion, but maybe 2 years later they would want to look at solid waste, there's got to be some interesting journey that gets them from year one to year two and then onto their transfer institution. And that by pulling people into a major and saying you can only take what fits here, do you have any sort of advice about how we manage that and still allow all that beauty?
Part of your question has to do with legislation that is trying to ease completion, transfer, not have complexities get in the way of a student's work. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yeah.
I actually made a presentation to a group of presidents of community colleges in Maryland earlier this summer, and I didn't give them this idea, but I was talking about integrative learning, and one of the presidents, not of any of these three campuses, said, I love what you're talking about, and I actually teach a capstone at my institution that is problem-centered, that is integrative, that's cross-disciplinary, and it will be the first to go, she said, in light of the new legislation. I can only offer you what employers advise us. So I'm quoting an employer that we talked with last week at our annual meeting, and he said, the fact of the matter is employers have far more currency with the legislature than you do. The academics cannot, I mean, it's a terrible thing to say, but I had a certain ring of conviction to me, credibility to me. He said, you have to go in arm in arm with employers, and they have to be the ones who say, we want students who are working on complex problems, and we don't want them locked into only a single discipline. you have to find advocates to go in and say, if people are really going to be ready for this economy, they need integrative experiences, problem-centered inquiry. Also, that survey I alluded to and gave you little snippets of has a lot that's in it that's useful for making this case. Of all the items we gave employers, the one that got the high in terms of all students should, the one that got the highest score was 91%. All students should have experiences solving problems with people who are different from themselves. Well, I've already shown you the items on the broad arts and sciences and so forth. And there's another item in there, the fourth time we've asked this question in four different surveys. To be well prepared for this economy, should students primarily focus on the knowledge and skills they need for a particular job or career? Or should they have broad knowledge primarily? Or should they have a combination of broad and specialized knowledge? Overwhelmingly, people want that combination of broad and specialized knowledge. And in the last survey, the one that we brought out in April, only 15% of employers said specialized knowledge alone. 20% of them said broad knowledge alone, interestingly. And then another 55% combination of breadth and depth. So I think we have just got to get ourselves organized to persuade the legislature that what they think of as a kindness for students, just mapping those pathways with what I like to think of as the latest curricular ideas in 1950, Gen Ed defined as so many courses in this category and so many in that category, and interdisciplinary learning, much less global interdisciplinary learning, not even on the radar screen. We have to mobilize and build a broader legislative understanding that this way lies decline. It does not lie. Global leadership cannot rest on a curriculum that was current in 1950. And too many of our Gen Ed pathways are exactly that.
South and Maria, geography?
Yes, my name is Sally Rich. And this is maybe a little bit off topic or something, but one of the problems that I face beginning of every semester is just trying to explain what geography is to students. It's one of those disciplines that very few students study in high school. Very few people get it and don't quite know what it is. And what I'm thinking is, in the point of view of making it easier for students to try to understand what courses they should take, what they might want to be interested in, and how that matches what they are interested in, is I've looked through our catalog and the course catalogs of many other schools, and I'll be darned if I can figure out what the heck most courses are about reading the description in a catalog, which seems to be written for some bureaucrat somewhere. And I think one of the things we really need to do in all of our schools, not just us here, but lots of schools need to do this, is just really simplify this into everyday English.
Right.
Get exciting about it.
Right.
I remember one time, there was, at another university where I went, there was a sort of a free-for-all place where you can get information about different classes, and different departments would throw out little brochures about what courses they were offering. And you'd open it up, and the first description of like one course in history was, you know, murder, mayhem, this, that, stuff like that. Want to read all about this? You know, read about what happened when the Vikings attacked this. And, oh, this sounds pretty interesting, pretty exciting. It was this idea that it got me interested in certain courses. Why can't we write a catalog that really explains what courses are about? Take a little bit more room. We've got plenty of room. It's on the internet now. We don't have to print it out.
Right.
Take a little bit more room and get students to actually understand what is going on. If they're interested in a certain problem, it gives them a better sense of saying, oh, gee, you know, they do in archaeology is really what I'm looking for. Maybe it's not history. Maybe it's this. It gets them to at least go over and talk to somebody in the department. Too many students just, you know, like we said, they have no idea what courses they want to take. They're taking courses because they can't take anything from 1 to 5 to working, so they only take courses at 9 to 12 in the morning or something like that. And they just are lost.
Well, I think I agree with just about everything you're saying. And I think it's not just a, you know, this isn't a problem we can solve one faculty member at a time. I think these are departmental program and institutional level responsibilities. The institution needs to have done more than just say what outcomes it reported to Middle States as expected for all its students. It needs to bring the students and the faculty and the adjunct faculty doing a lot of the teaching into the dialogue. I loved your comment, Daniel, that you use a rubric to assess the assignments you're doing to see what to know that you are doing them right. I don't think we're giving enough rubrics to our colleagues as to what this program is about, what it is trying to help students learn to do, or why it needs other programs to complement what it's about. So to my mind, a key question, you talk about both making it more exciting, but also more accessible. I think we need to be asking, as groups of faculty, disciplinary and cross-disciplinary, what problems does our work help society solve? What are the characteristic problems that you can tackle with my field, my center, our work? You know, what are the issues? Issues, questions, problems. And then I think we need to be much better able to explain why those problems matter and to whom, and then how every course is actually building experience in tackling illustrative questions and problems. I'm old enough now to have a granddaughter who's gone to college, and she did community college courses. This is, of course, another part of the country, Texas, which counted for high school as well as for her gen eds in college, history and political science. She didn't have a single written word in either course. She had multiple choice midterms and multiple choice finals. Now, when I suggested that perhaps this was not the best possible preparation for that world I was talking about, she was very indignant. She loves, and I'm guessing a lot of your students are the same way, she loves it. She had 120 average in her history course for the extra credit multiple choice questions. But she hadn't written a paragraph in either course, and it counted for high school and it counted for college. To my mind, that is malpractice. We ought to be saying to ourselves, in every course, in every experience, students are doing some analytical work at an appropriate level. It may be different levels for different students. But we're expecting them to tackle a problem, bring evidence to bear, examine contested positions on their problem, possibly get out into the community to ask people who are not academics what they think, people who are not in school, but to build their capacity to actually tackle issues and problems relevant to the field, relevant to society, and to be able to explain. We should be able to explain, and eventually the students should be able to explain why this matters. And I think that has been our problem, and especially a problem for the liberal arts. We liked to say, we're not preparing you for any career, we're preparing you for all careers. You can think about that later. That's what I went to school on. I bet a lot of you went to school on it too. We didn't get a lot of practice in explaining how what we were doing related to real world issues. And we need developmental education ourselves on this score. So,
Kelly
Rudin,
history.
I'm Kelly Rudin, I teach history.
No, this is good actually, because when you say it and she says it, I actually more likely remember it.
Just to piggyback on this, our college freshmen this year are the first students to have gone through all of their education since No Child Left Behind. And so we've got an entire, all of our kids now were trained with multiple choice tests. And so it's not just a matter of choosing one of four or five answers. They also have no idea how to ask questions. So just asking a question, because the questions have been handed to them, yeah. And the idea is you can assess Asian history up to 1500 with 25 questions, and each question has one choice. I tell them, try to have a relationship like that. Try to have a marriage like that. It's just, you know, not there. So I would like to know, I think it's a big challenge for all of us. I think it's a challenge for our nation, and I think the other part of that is that we as a nation don't value the intelligence of our youth. we have dumbed down education to meet just below mediocre. Yeah. And so students in the inner city, students who are minorities, we've known for decades that, of course, the way to get at these kids is to challenge them and do exactly this. But how many people will say, they couldn't handle it, they couldn't handle it. And that, I've been in the classroom for 34 years, and so, this is I think it's so devastating that we don't trust the intelligence of our young
people. Now, I'm sure that is a huge problem, and you're going to be the ones to help students see and feel how college is different from what they've experienced before. There was an amazing story, probably some of you saw it, a front page story in the Washington Post, I think maybe a year ago, May. And it was a student who'd come through a charter school in DC. Somebody's nodding over there. And he had obviously done well, and he was at Georgetown. So this was the first person narrative that they put on the front page of the Washington Post. And he was talking about his history, going to public schools and finally being picked up by a charter school that helped him get to a place like Georgetown. But in his first year English class, the faculty member had students, first of all, he thought he did well on his first paper. He got a D plus. But they shared papers so that students could look at one another's papers. And for the first time, he realized that the class was full of people who didn't just write short constructed answers, which he'd been taught to do to get through the various tests. That for the first time he saw that other people had been taught how to think for themselves and to make an argument. Now this is obviously a very smart kid, because within a year he's able to write retrospectively and persuasively about the difference between what he got and what people who didn't go to that kind of training factory got, and to understand that his future lay with the difference, thinking for yourself. I think we have to create as many opportunities as we can for students to see the difference between routinized thinking and their own, however tentative, think of me proving that the Catholic Church is one true church. That was my question. However tentative and ill-formed the questions they have, we have to find ways to give them, to see that they're developing a voice and that we need their voice and their analytic powers, whatever they're studying. Yes?
We have a question from a student in the Dartmouth shirt.
I was just wondering, it's kind of building off of Daniel's question, but I was lucky enough to go to Poolsville High School, where I also did a senior project with a magnet program.
I'm sorry, what kind of a high school?
Poolsville. It was a magnet program.
Oh, okay.
And so I did a senior project on Hawaiian history, where I'm from. And I was just wondering, is there funds, faculty, resources for that kind of individualized education that you're stressing, which I think is really important, but is it possible?
I think it has to be built into the expected curricular design for different programs and departments. It's not possible for, I don't know how many tens of thousands of students there are at Montgomery College. It's not possible for each of us to have an independent study and a personal mentor who's going to help us do it. But it's entirely possible to be part of a sequence that includes a project of some sort, which you might do collaboratively. There are institutions where every student does a senior project as part of a group of five or six people, and they're working on different aspects of the research and the problem. But if we see it as something that's layered on top of the regular program, it won't work. But the fact of the matter is, it is entirely possible to tell students in history, for example, one of the things you're supposed to be able to do is to analyze an historical problem. And so we're going to build experiences getting ready to do that into every course we offer. So in some courses, we're going to be working on documents. Some courses, we're going to be working on voices, oral history. But before you're done, you're actually going to deliver that. It's going to be part of a requirement in the course.
Sharon Newworth,
an English language program at BSN,
and she's also teaching our faculty fellowship.
Mm-hmm.
Hi.
Many of us recently read the article related to the completion agenda in Atlantic Monthly magazine, where it said that the way to get students through is basically push them through with a specific curriculum and no ifs, ands, or buts. You just work your way through and you're committed all the way through. that may be fine for people who just want to get their degree, that doesn't match anything that you've talked about today. And but in terms, it makes me wonder, in terms of getting the message out to as many people as possible, I wonder if the AAC&U and other organizations are trying to reach out to the wider community and not just to educators. I mean, the things you're saying affect the decisions made at the college level and at the classroom level, but I think you need a sea change in what the general public expects from education.
A really good point. Let me pick up two parts of what you just put on the table. One is the notion of the guided pathways. There is a lot of research showing that when students have less choice and they're in a well-structured program, this is community college research coming out of Columbia, they're significantly more likely to finish than if they have an ocean of choices and, as I would argue, often no reason to understand why they're doing this, that, or the other. So actually what I'm talking about is creating guided pathways that have all this in it. But this is part of the expected regimen, not just taking a bunch of courses in the right order with the right numbers, but actually a purposeful regimen that is has some choice in it, but not unlimited choice. You're actually expected to go on the pathways that are teaching you how to solve a problem, or at least to interpret and frame a problem for others to carry forth a solution. We have just gotten funding from the Gates Foundation. I say that with mixed feelings. But I actually think they are starting to see the limitations in the completion agenda as they have helped fuel it in recent years. So the project will focus on general education. It is creating purposeful problem-centered, inquiry-centered pathways for general education. It's taking issue with the notion that gen ed is something to get out of the way as soon as possible and possibly in high school. Be trying to braid broad learning all the way through a four-year sequence, foundations in the first 2 years, advanced integrative problem-centered work expected in the last 2 years. It's called GEMS, General Education Maps and Models. And the whole idea is to build from a lot of good examples we see all over the place. In open admissions institutions as well as selective ones to try to create more purposeful, engaging, inquiry-oriented experiences with general education. Somebody, Luc Menand, you may know him at Harvard, has said in a Harvard report on gen ed, general education should be the public face of liberal education. It should be the place where we're answering the so what question. Why does this matter? What is the academy about? What will you get here? And I have that notion in mind in this project, this GEMS project, that we need to create purposeful, guided pathways, some choice, not unlimited choice, that are intentionally building students' capacity to see themselves as problem solvers and to engage in deep inquiry at many levels. And then when we do that, they will be GEMS, and general education will be much more GEM-like than it often is today. And as I don't need to tell you, general education is where most students experience all of their humanities study and social sciences study as well. So that's trying to turn the completion agenda to, and some of the insights that have guided it to a more educationally useful direction. And then the second part of your question, the public dialogue. Interestingly, we just had a conversation with our Gates program officer on just exactly that point. Well, shouldn't you be thinking about the will building? And your, you know, outreach to legislators. We are a staff of 55 people, and there are 50 states, 1,300 institutional members. We have made it our primary business to work with you, to learn from you, to try to hold up the better examples of your work, to see where things could go. But increasingly, and the employer work is all part of that, we have been trying to build a more influential public voice for the kind of learning we're talking about. We're certainly, you know, we're far from cracking that public nut, but I think we are trying to work more successfully in that vein, and apparently Gates would like us to think about how they could help. So we'll see.
I'm sorry, you had a question earlier.
Yeah. I'm Debbie Preston, I'm dean for the arts. And you know, I'm really, I'm optimistic about this agenda because I think the main thing we have to do is get out of the way of the students. And I've been curious about whether the students agree with this, but I've been reading a lot about millennial students. I was out of the classroom as an administrator for about 8 years, and then I taught a class and went, oh my God, I don't even know these people. So I did a lot of reading, and one of the characteristics that you read a lot about millennial students is that they really do give a damn about what's going on in the world, and they really want meaningful careers and meaningful work, much more than our generation did. I mean, as a whole, right? And this is a curriculum that really speaks to that. And I think what we have to do is to help students make the connection that the things they care about can be found, the solutions, the capacity to solve the problems they want to solve can be found. And I would add in the arts and humanities, right? So I think, and we get in their way as educators and as parents. You know, I can't tell you how many students have sat in my office and said, well, I really want to be an artist, but my dad's making me major in chemistry. I never had someone say, well, I really want to be a chemist, but my dad's making me.
We're looking for those people.
it does happen, but I think if we can find ways to help students realize that the things they want to accomplish, and I do see that in the generation of students we're working with, can be accomplished with the skills they can learn in humanities. Not that they all have to be humanities majors, but that those skills can really help them. And then I think they have a right to understand that, you know, I have a 13-year-old, and she's much more like a college, you know, her mindset. And she's constantly saying about her schoolwork, why should I care about that? And as much as it drives me crazy, I'm really proud of her for asking that question. You know, why should she care about that? And I think our students have a right to get that information. And then I think they'll be the first ones that will buy this if we will let them.
I'm interested in how the students in the room are responding to what she's just said. I'm not sure I can solve all those problems. First of all, I'm curious as to whether or not you saw promise in what I was recommending before, that in fact every class ought to be able to spend some time on why are we doing this? What kinds of questions, problems, issues will this course address, and why should anyone care? Do you think that would help?
If they're interested and even curious to understand it, where some of them just don't shared, whereas some people are eager to learn and apply it to their lives. But then another thing is that some professors don't have a lot of time, you know, within their schedule, and they can only do so much, and half the time you have to figure, you have to, you know, find out for your own. And like I said, it depends on the person themselves if they're interested in it or not.
And one of the things I've learned from the work we were doing is that students are more likely to listen to another student than they are to somebody my age. And so I think we have to find ways of empowering the students who are engaged with their studies, who have gotten something out of them, who are farther along, maybe who have transferred to somewhere else, to come back and be, at least in brief learning community discussions, with people who are still on that journey. But the other piece of it is, when students say, if you say a student just doesn't care, or it doesn't connect with their life and so they don't care, part of what I'm saying is we have to go out of our way to find ways to connect the assignments with the lives they're living and the question. Everybody has something they care about. It may not be captured on this particular syllabus, but everyone has something they care about. And our job, I think, as educators, is to do a better job of connecting the students' actual questions, however irrelevant they may seem to be, to the work of the academy and the larger learning that is possible. I think we do much less than we could to connect with the job students have. When I first went to work after doing my doctoral work at Harvard, followed my husband to Chicago and found myself working with returning adult learners. Now, two things stood out about these people. One, they had all been to college earlier. They had all dropped out. That's why they were returning adults. Most of them had been to community colleges, and most of them had terrible grades. And whatever they were doing there, it wasn't showing up in A's on their transcripts or B's. And yet, I am talking to very capable, very articulate people who have actually done enough with their lives to be able to come back to school on top of everything else. Some of them actually quite successful, but all of them doing something that mattered to them. And it was the first time the thought crossed my mind, maybe it wasn't that they failed or did badly in college. Maybe we weren't well organized to tap into their talents, because they clearly have them. It's really influenced my thinking that we have to take more seriously the notion that every student has some potential, some strength, some capacity, something they care about. And all too often, the way we've organized our time and our courses doesn't open up those possibilities. So I think more can be done. Maybe not for everybody, but for a lot of students, I think there are a lot of ways to probe more deeply into what they're actually about and help them see more potential in school.
Can I put you on the spot, Carolyn?
What do you want, Rita?
Carolyn, Terry, acting or intern?
Intern.
Associate VP for Academic Affairs.
There you go.
Thank you.
Okay, so what would you like to put me on the spot for, Rita? Let me just tell you what I'm thinking.
You've been responding.
Yes, do tell me. Do tell me what you think.
Yes. I have such hope, like Debbie. Debbie and I did the presentation about what it's like, because I was out of class for 13 years before I went back in, and we did that presentation at AFAC last month. I went into the classroom with a box of chalk, believe it or not. I put that away. But I think what you're talking about is there are two key things that are going on right now at Montgomery College. One is that we have a general education transformation and reform committee. And I see members sitting around the room. In fact, Michael Farrell behind us is one of the co-chairs. Mohammed Kenawi is another. There's Tammy. Okay, so we've got English, art, engineering.
A great combination.
And as you're talking, I'm leaning back to Michael, did you write that down? And he's dutifully writing them down. And he did it before I said it. But it's because we are just now starting on the process of asking our faculty, what is the academic value? What is the set of academic values that we feel that a globalized student, a globalized perspective, that a student in a contemporary society needs to have? And it's everything that you're saying is everything that we've been talking about and everything that we've been bringing out. So we just had our first set of meetings yesterday.
And we had this great collection of faculty. We have round two tomorrow at the Georgetown campus. And they were all talking about these same things, about the idea of not just checking off a box and not just saying, hey, I have to take 6 credits in this and it's, you know, 7 credits in that. And, hey, do I have to take that PE class? So it was a very rich conversation. I think that we are poised to have it and to do it well. So some of the resources that you're talking about, very helpful. We're also going to try and bring a team to your summer institute.
Yes, I heard that. Maybe do a couple of them.
Right. Sharon Fechter is also on. She's writing the proposal, so she's got that down to you. Right? So, but at the same time, the second project that we're working on is the reformation and transformation of general studies, which is our, not general education, but is our largest curriculum that students graduate from, which has up until now been basically check off the boxes and gather your credits and get the 60 between the gen ed and the general studies and transfer. Mm-hmm. And we are struggling, and I think we are making great progress in creating concentrations within mm-hmm. those 30 credit hours mm-hmm. of general, 30 to 36 credit hours of general studies, to ask students from the early point on, what are you interested in?
Yeah.
What do you want to study? What kinds of experiences are valuable to you? And what Rita and Sarah and Lucy and I don't know anybody else in that committee have been talking about is taking these high impact learning opportunities like fellowships and honors courses and internships, which we offer to far too few students, and giving them those opportunities as significant events in their education mm-hmm. to help them bring coherence mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. to their 30 credit hours or 36 yeah. credit hours yeah. of general studies. Yeah. So I think we're right where we should be.
It sounds that way, and it sounds to me as though we should be talking. That right now the GEMS project it's been funded very lavishly
yes.
for a design year. We have to deliver, you know,
right.
deliverables, a whole slew of things. But one of the things we have to deliver is evidence of interest
right.
from broad access institutions
right.
and community yeah. colleges are, you know, favorite friends. Good. Because I think the kinds of questions you were long since asking before I ever got here about what does it mean to be prepared for a globalized world, it's exactly where we need to go. And we need people like you telling funders that your students need more than maybe they've been delivering. I understand I'm being lobbied on your application.
Both applications.
Right. The institutes are competitive, especially Gen Ed, but you know, I can be lobbied.
I'm Clarice Summersall. Dr. Schneider, I've seen you on so many different occasions, but most recently last May, I believe it was last May, at the AAC&U conference in Miami.
Oh, okay.
And I went
yeah.
up to you and Deborah.
Humphreys.
Mm-hmm. Because for the very longest time, Montgomery College has used your Greater Expectations publication as one of the bookends of us becoming more learning-centered.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
And I know that you moved from Greater Expectations and the focus on that to LEAP and then Roadmap. And I know that Prince George's is a Roadmap
yes.
institution.
Mm-hmm.
But the connecting thread has always been liberal education yeah. and creating students who are passionate about what they're studying.
And who practical liberal education. If you're using Greater Expectations, you know.
Yes.
Page 24, 25, liberal education has to become more practical.
That's exactly right. And my question to you is, in your evolution, you're talking about GEMS, what do you see as the next step going forward in the interface with employers, in the interface with higher education? And is there real impetus for an institution to become a roadmap institution? What are the bennies?
Right. Well, I think we would have liked Montgomery College to be a roadmap institution. I think we were encouraged to apply. I don't think you did. And you've done a very good job of laying out the pathways. Greater Expectations was our opportunity to really go to the higher education community and say, What is it you think students need? LEAP was a recognition that what you thought they needed, we were only delivering to some, that we were going to have to ramp this up to create a more inclusive and dynamic momentum for it. And I actually think we've done that. I think that there's so much participation in LEAP all around the country, even by places that I don't even know are participating. And GEMS is an effort to try to seize the digital revolution. What are some of the ways in which we can use digital resources? But also, how can we use the evidence on what works for first-generation students, put all of that together in a remapped design for general education? In terms of how we see employers and roadmaps, GEMS would leap back to roadmap in that we're trying to map the pathways. You saw me using that language, trying to map the pathways, especially at broad access institutions that serve first-generation students, and trying to create much more useful pathways between 2 and 4 year institutions as students are on that pathway. So we would need to get more funding for Roadmap for there to be access to it, but I'm pretty certain there are going to be other opportunities for community colleges to be working with us, unless we fail miserably in year one of GEMS. Okay. GEMS leads directly to folks like you, or should. And so that's hopefully an opportunity. In terms of employers, I have not really thought, what is the next step with employers other than to keep trying to, I mean, we're doing a series of forums around the country. We just did one in Boston, we're planning one in Philadelphia, there's going to be others, where we're trying to get employers out in front of policymakers to say the kinds of things I know they will say if asked. We did one in Washington in April. But what we really don't have is a strategy for vastly multiplying the number of them that are heard or who are influential. So I'd take advice on this one.
I'd love to have a
hands just went up.
I'd love to have a conversation with you about what we're doing with Accenture and Discovery Communications. Because we're doing exactly that. We're listening to them. They're coming to our institution to talk to our students about real world skills that the students need. Global understanding is one of the top ones.
Yeah.
And so we'll talk then.
Yeah, okay. A couple of hands went up when I said I'd take your advice on this, so let's, your hand over there.
Margaret Lauber. I'd like to address two things, sort of piggybacking off of what Carolyn said and some of the students have said. We don't have the ability, as was noted, to offer every student a capstone course, that kind of rich experience where you're interacting with one faculty member. But we do, even before general education is reconstituted, we do have existing general education competencies, proficiencies, and we have outcomes for every course for every program. When those are being developed, one of the questions asked was, are we going to tell the students what they are? And I think one of the things, and I know it goes on in many classrooms, is the students can be told what those outcomes are, should be told what they are. The general education competencies and proficiencies should be threaded through every course. So the engineering student who is having to write something should be reminded that engineers who cannot write work for those who can. the psychology class or the history class who is having to look at the accounting during the French Revolution in Elbeuf, France, and understand, you know, here's the numbers, here's why you need to be able to do some quantitative thinking in a history class. Those are threads that even without a capstone course, if at the beginning of each semester, in addition to that syllabus that we all crank through, if those are shared and repeatedly so that students hear that throughout different courses, it might not quite equate to a capstone, but it certainly gives the sense that there is purpose, there are some common themes that we hope after the 2 years or 3 years or however long someone is here, they walk away with something that is richer than just the list of courses on their transcript.
Yeah.
And I think that's something that we can all do today.
Yeah.
And then the other point I want to make in terms of the employers, and going into Rita, what you were talking about today in terms of the humanities, in the last couple of weeks I've had two experiences where we're working on building out our life sciences park here and talking to prospective tenants in that. And I was at a meeting last week with some of the cybersecurity employers in the county. both emphasized communication, global thinking, and you will be thrilled to know that one of the cybersecurity employers said, I have philosophy and English majors working for me because of their creative thinking.
Okay. Exactly, and what we need is to find ways of putting that in front of every student, not just the ones that happen into the right classes.
Right.
And that's where I'm I'm not a millennial. I am sure there are possibilities for the use of social media to do this, that I need others to both design and execute, but it's very clear to me that we need much more expansive engagement of our publics and policy leaders with what employers say to us whenever we ask. However we ask, whenever we ask, they reliably say, don't send us narrowly trained people who can't write and think. Whatever else they will or won't say, they certainly say that. Mm-hmm. And you obviously, we had people, Northrop Grumman, the senior person in charge of all their human resources, spoke at the release of our employer survey last year, and she was challenged, as employers always are, well, you say this, you say you're looking for these broad outcomes, you're saying all the right things, but your frontline people, they're not recruiting for this. And she said, as a matter of fact, we have trained our frontline people to recruit for just this. And that's the kind of thing we need everybody to be saying. So it's a work in progress, but employers are definitely key to it.
I'm going to say that we stop here now. Feel free to chat with Dr. Schneider one-on-one. I told Carol Moore that I would remind you that there's a sign-up sheet out there, so please make sure that you've signed in. There's a clipboard that she's holding right now. We have refreshments. We have great creative minds. Mingle. Thank you so much for coming today.
Welcome back. I want to express my appreciation to Dr. Schneider for her presentation, Giving Students a Compass, New Directions for the Global Humanities. I hope you enjoyed it, and I trust you will benefit from it. Additional speakers in our series and other events will be announced soon, so please check our website for details on upcoming events. And before we go, I want to remind everyone that the Global Humanities Institute invites the participation of area scholars and students, as well as community members, in its programs and event offerings. For more information, you can contact me directly. And finally, if you'd care to help the Global Humanities Institute meet our grand challenge, please contact the Montgomery College Foundation. So once again, for everyone at Montgomery College's Global Humanities Institute, thank you so much for joining us.